The title of our message today is Suppose. Suppose. Suppose that you had been living around the year 680 BC. This is during the time of the reign of Manasseh. It is in full speed. The systematic destruction of the worship of Jehovah is almost finished. And the worship of idols, the worship of Baal, Moloch, Ashtaroth, Chemosh, and other pagan deities, they are in full swing. We read about this in 2 Kings 21. I'd like for you to turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 21. Verse 1. Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign, and reigned 55 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Hephzibah. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, after the abominations of the heathen, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. For he built up again the high places which Hezekiah his father had destroyed, and he reared up altars for Baal, and made a grove, as did Ahab, king of Israel, and worshipped all the hosts of heaven, and served them. And he built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord said in Jerusalem, I put my name. And he built altars for all the hosts of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. And he made his son pass through the fire, and observed times, and used enchantments, and dealt with familiar spirits and wizards. He wrought much wickedness in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Verse 7. And he set a graven image of the grove that he had made in the house, of which the Lord said to David and to Solomon his son, in this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all tribes of Israel, will I put my name forever. Neither will I make the feet of Israel move any more out of the land which I gave their fathers, only if they observe to do according to all that I have commanded them, and according to all the law that my servant Moses commanded them. But they hearken not, and Manasseh seduced them to do more evil than did the nations whom the Lord destroyed before the children of Israel. I don't know how we could write a worst case scenario of apostasy, friends. Manasseh had obtained idolatrous priests, and we can be sure that he was politically correct concerning the Sodomites. There were no attempts to stop the wizards, the necromancers either. We know this because it says this here, and also because of information that we do have in chapter 23, and we could turn over to chapter 23. Because there was a grandson of Manasseh whose name was Josiah. And the 18th year of his reign, and he only started reigning when he was 8 years old, so when he was about 26 years old, he began to have some serious reforms. And the king stood by a pillar and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all their heart and all their soul, to perform the words of this covenant that were written in the book. And all the people stood to the covenant. And the king commanded Hilkiah the high priest, and the priests of the second order, and the keepers of the door, to bring forth out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels that were made for Baal and for the grove, and for all the hosts of heaven, and he burned them without Jerusalem in the fields of Kidron, and he carried the ashes of them unto Bethel. And he put down the idolatrous priests, whom the kings of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah and in Jerusalem. And then going to verse 12, just reading some of it. And the altars that were on the top of the upper chamber of Ahaz, which the king of Judah had made, and the altars which Manasseh had made in the two courts of the house of the Lord, did the king beat down and break them down from thence, and cast the dust of them into the brook Kidron. And also we could read verse 24, moreover, the workers with familiar spirits, and the wizards, and the images, and the idolaters, and all the abominations that were spied in the land of Judah and in Jerusalem, did Josiah put away, that he might perform the words of the law of the book. And so he did all these things. Verse 7, he broke down the houses of the Sodomites that were by the house of the Lord. So I want you to just stop and get a picture, based upon what we read here in chapter 23, of what Josiah tried to reform, because it needed to be reformed, because their problem was there. and the picture that's being presented in chapter 21. Among the nation who were to be the people of God, inside the city of God, inside the very courts of the temple of the city of God, of the people of God, we find in this temple dedicated to do the service for Jehovah, we find pagan altars, we find instruments for pagan service, we even find a pagan grove inside the court of the Lord. And friends, you don't grow a grove overnight. If you go back a little bit, Ahaz went to Damascus in chapter 11 of Kings. We read about King Ahaz. He went to Damascus at one point, and he became infatuated with an altar there that he was commanded to worship. And he went back to Jerusalem and told the priest, build me an altar like this. He took the blueprint back and they put an altar there in the house of the Lord. And they actually moved the brazen altar to the side so it wouldn't obscure the view of the worshiper at the false altar. I mean, this was the kind of sin that was going on in 680 B.C. If you had remained true to Jehovah, suppose you had remained true to Jehovah, would you have went to that temple in 680 BC to worship Jehovah? Now, the Jews clearly were the chosen people of God. God said so. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 12, beginning in verse 9. He says, for ye are not as yet come to the rest and to the inheritance which the Lord your God giveth you. He says, I'm going to give you something. In verse 13, he says, take heed to thyself that thou offer not the burnt offerings in every place that thou seest, but in the place which the Lord shall choose in one of thy tribes, there shalt thou offer thy burnt offerings, and there shalt thou do all that I command thee. He says, you're my people, and I'm going to give you a special place to do these offerings. And we know that he did this in Jerusalem, but let's go to Deuteronomy 32 and verse 9. It says, for the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. Psalms 48 and verse 2. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. What city was that? That's Jerusalem, isn't it? It's Jerusalem. And that temple, friends, that temple was the place in Jerusalem that they were to worship. In 1 Kings again, 1 Kings chapter 8, Solomon is praying the dedicatory prayer of that temple. And he says in verse 33, when thy people Israel be smitten down before the enemy, because they have sinned against thee, and shall turn again to thee, and confess thy name, and pray, make supplication unto thee in this house, then hear thou in heaven, and forgive the sin of thy people Israel, and bring them again into the land which thou gavest unto their fathers. When heaven is shut up, and there is no rain. Did that actually happen? Just seven chapters later. Because they have sinned against thee, if they pray toward this place and confess thy name and turn from their sin, when thou afflictest them, then hear thou in heaven and forgive the sin of thy servants and of thy people Israel, that thou teach them the good way wherein they should walk, and give rain unto thy land, which thou hast given to thy people for an inheritance. There can be, friends, no question, that God had ordained this group of people, he had ordained this city, and he had ordained this temple. But it was not the temple, and it was not the city, and nor was it the nation that they were to worship. And while it's true that the place at one time had been blessed, that blessing was dependent upon God being there. It was not counting, friends, if God was not there. It did not count if God's priests were not there. It did not count if his services were not there. Perhaps you've heard this said, but I go there because I'm a member of that church. Well, why? Well, because I've always been a member of that church. And that's what a lot of people probably said in that day. I know that they worship Baal there. I know that the preacher believes in Baal there. But this is God's church. And this is where we're to go worship. And God said so. We tend to think that the worship of Baal and the worship of Jehovah were very distinct. But here, friends, we make a great mistake. While some of the worship of some of the pagan gods, like Moloch, where they would pass their children through fire, obviously was very distant in some respects from the worship of Jehovah, the worship of this thunder god, this rain god that was called Baal, was in fact very similar to the worship of Jehovah. Some scholars declare that there was actually very little difference between the Jews' religion and that of the Babylonian pagans. These similarities became a stumbling block to Israel, who were continually being deceived into the various forms of apostate worship. Notice what one scholar said concerning this reading. In spite of all the changing ideas through the years, ancient Babylon in the days of the Old Testament prophets still presents to the student a marvelous counterfeit of the revealed religion of God. In general plan, for instance, the temples of Babylonia, Egypt, and Assyria have much in common with the Temple of Solomon. So much so that Dr. Say said, the Temple of Solomon, in fact, was little more than a reproduction of a Babylonian sanctuary. Not only were the Babylonian temples similar to that of Solomon, I just pass here for a minute, the temples of Baal, you know, they had a holy and a most holy place. They had two compartments. Not only were the Babylonian temples similar to that of Solomon, but strikingly similarities are found in their priesthood and ritual. Every great Babylonian sanctuary had its priests with a high priest at their head. The priest was the mediator between the worshiper and his God. Animals without blemish were offered as sacrifices, and there were also meal offerings. Morning and evening sacrifice was conducted daily. A tithe of all the land produced belonged to the priests as well as certain portions of the sacrifices. Old Babylon had her sacred books and the penitential psalms. The latter resemble somewhat the songs of the Old Testament. In studying these, together with their myths and epics, which were largely on the subject of religion, one finds many concepts and ideas that in a remarkable way parallel the true. And that's from the prophetic significance of God's judgments upon Babylon, a thesis from the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary, and I've quoted that from the book 1888 Reexamined on page 152. Well, Ellen White noted, notice what she says, in Testimonies for the Church, volume 3, pages 280 and 281. What astonishing deception and fearful blindness had like a dark cloud covered Israel. This blindness and apostasy had not closed about them suddenly. It had come upon them gradually. Let me just pause. If you have something that's very distinct and different, you know, if you can see it, it's more easier to recognize. A counterfeit has to look something like the original to fool people. But if you can bring even changes that are we might say radical, if you can bring them in subtly, gradually, a little at a time, people become accustomed to the change. And then one generation passes to the next. And we're talking about a period of about 100 years, friends, it took to bring Israel to this level of apostasy or more. She goes on to say, this blindness and apostasy had not closed about them suddenly. It had come upon them gradually, as they had not heeded the word of reproof and warning which the Lord had sent to them because of their pride and their sins. And now speaking specifically in the time of Elijah, she says, and now in this fearful crisis, in the presence of the idolatrous priest and the apostate king, they remain neutral. If God abhors one sin above another, of which his people are guilty, it is doing nothing in the case of an emergency. Indifference and neutrality in a religious crisis is regarded of God as a grievous crime and equal to the very worst type of hostility against God. Now, the context of this statement was the time of Elijah. But I tell you, by the time we get to the time of Manasseh in Judah, it's very little different than the parallel of what was happening in the northern kingdom of Israel at the time of Elijah. If anything, it's worse. And to be neutral, to say, well, look, I'm going to go worship in the house of the Lord, even though I know they're worshiping Baal there, and I'm not going to say anything about it. I'm just going to be my little quiet church mouse there, and I'll just, you know, I'll witness by my life. Friends, it's neutrality. And it's a crime against your God, if indeed you really do believe in the true God. Sometimes things appear as business as usual. There's no reason to worry. Our ministers have general conference credentials, and that tells me that they are real. It tells me that I can trust them. But remember, we talked in our story a little bit ago about Frank Abagnale. When he was but a teenager, Frank Abagnale posed as a Pan Am pilot getting free rides on over 250 flights to 26 countries. He wrote over $2.5 million worth of bad checks, posed as a doctor, lawyer, broker, and even university professor, all before the age of 21. He forged checks, documents, and identifications. He looked real. He looked real enough to fool thousands and thousands of people. And I tell you, friends, there are today ministers of Baal who are masquerading, claiming to be ministers of Jehovah. And there are churches that are masquerading, claiming to be churches of Jehovah that are churches of Baal. And the people don't recognize the difference. Suppose you had been living in 680 BC during the time of Manasseh, and there's a grove in the temple. There's the worship of Baal in the temple. There's an altar for Baal in the temple. There are the instruments of worshiping Baal in the temple of God. You're going to go in there and worship? Really? I'm going to tell you, it was subtle. It was subtle then, and it's subtle today. And people go into churches today, and they think they're worshiping Jehovah. They have crosses. They have crucifix. They have steeples on their churches. They have these subtle little forms that should tell you, if you know what you're looking for, that this is not the place Jehovah's worshipped. Amen. And the people don't know the difference. To Frank's credit, I should tell you that he got out of prison. Later, a book about his life became a bestseller, followed by a movie and a Broadway play. And today, Frank works for the FBI as a legitimate specialist on fraud control and has his own consulting company. But he can tell you better than anyone else that sometimes the false looks very much like the real. And in fact, we have been told that the track of truth lies close beside the track of error. And both tracks may seem to be one to minds which are not worked by the Holy Spirit and which, therefore, are not quick to discern the difference between truth and error. Remember that the name Baal in patriarchal times meant husband, the one who was the master, the Baal of the wife. While the husband early in the Bible is simply translated from the Hebrew word ish, meaning man, the woman could say, in other words, we might say in Appalachian vernacular, he's my man. Well, when a woman in the old times said, he's my husband, that's what she said, he's my man. But there was another word that came into the vernacular, and even in reputable places, and that was the name Baal, or the term Baal. And Baal meant husband or lord. Let me show you a couple places. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 4. A virtuous woman is a crown to her husband. A virtuous woman is a crown to her Baal. That's right. It's the same word in the Hebrew that's translated in 1 Kings 17 and 18. Baal worship. It just meant husband. It meant Lord. You want to see some more? Proverbs 31. You know what Proverbs 31 is about, don't you? About the virtuous woman. Verse 11. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her so that he shall have no need of spoil. But the Hebrew says the heart of her Baal. The heart of her Baal. Verse 23. Her Baal is known in the gates when he saith among the elders of the land. That's what the text says. You think that's something, don't you? Turn with me to Isaiah 54. Verse 5. For thy maker is thine husband, the Lord of hosts is his name. Now you know what Hebrew parallelism is and how it works. But you notice here, even in the King James Bible, they've capitalized the am in maker. Why? Because it's denoting deity, isn't it? And this the expression, for thy maker is thy husband, is parallel to the Lord of hosts is his name. And I ask you a question. Do you have an idea what Hebrew word is translated husband here? It's Baal. It's Baal. Now, it's not speaking about the same Baal that is the Phoenician god of thunder and weather. But it's simply using the term husband in the common vernacular of the day. I showed this text one time to a person who was very, as we would say, into this idea of what's called the sacred name. And, you know, of course, there's a text in the Bible where it says you're not even to take these false gods' name upon your name, you know, not to speak them. And they wouldn't even say the name Baal. I said, but do you know that Jehovah is called Baal in the Bible in one place? That can't be. That can't be. I showed them the text. They said, the text is wrong. It's a bad translation. Something's wrong because that can't be. But I tell you, all you got to do is get a Hebrew Bible, any Hebrew Bible, and look it up. The point I'm trying to make is, and I think it should be clear by now, that this distinction between what was called Baal worship and what was called the worship of Jehovah wasn't as clear cut to the surface reading person as you might think. There was a lot of confusion there. So when the prophets of Baal prayed on Mount Carmel, and they said, Oh Baal, hear us. They were simply saying in the common vernacular of the day, Oh Lord, hear us. Lord, hear us. A lot of the people didn't even know it was another God altogether. But Elijah knew that there was a difference in their conception of God. It was difficult for Israel to sense that they were really worshiping a false god when the name was the same as commonly used for the true God. Likewise today, the name of Christ is used with other Christian terminology. And yet, friends, it means nothing so far as identifying the truth. Doctrines and ideas possessing a verbal similarity to the truth, they may deceive many when the basic concepts are entirely different from the truth. It is not the name of the gods or the names of the doctrines, but friends, it is the moral characteristics that the unseen God and the unseen Christ had that determine whether they are false or whether they are real. Turn with me to John chapter 8. Notice what Jesus said about the Jews in his day. John chapter 8, and I'm going to start in verse 54. Jesus answered, If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God, yet ye have not known him. You say the Father is your God, but you haven't known him. They said the Father was their God, right? But who really was their God? Well, according to Jesus, if we go back now, verse 41, Jesus said, Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they unto him, We have not been born of fornication. We have one Father, even God. Jesus said unto them, If God were your Father, ye would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech, even because ye cannot hear my words? Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father will ye do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. That was their father. They said, the one you think of as father, the one we claim as Jehovah is our God, and he says, it's not at all. So we can have the right terminology, friends. We can use all the right words. But if we have wrong ideas, wrong ideas, therefore, are the vehicle for the introduction of a false Christ. It is of utmost importance that believers test their ideas, all their ideas of their Christ, by the teachings of the Word of God. Because, friends, to reject the words of Christ is more than to simply reject the words. It is to reject Christ himself. Jesus said in John chapter 6 and verse 63, The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And when we receive the words of Jesus Christ, we receive his spirit into our lives. But when we reject his words, we reject his spirit. We reject him. And friends, this means, and don't miss this point, this means that the expressed religious beliefs we have, and when I say expressed beliefs, I mean whether they are verbal or the things that we live out in our life. But these expressed religious beliefs that we hold and opinions of our persons are the ultimate true meter of the state of our heart. And if that belief and opinion are knowingly on the side of error, then whatever may be our outward appearance of holiness, our heart is at enmity of Him who is the truth. But, oh, Brother Allen, even though he teaches the Trinitarian doctrine, he has such a good message on health reform. Oh, Brother Allen, I know she rejects the second angel's message, but she helps the poor and needy so much. She's so good with the Dorcas Society. This might be true, friends, but if we knowingly are outside of the word of Jesus Christ, and especially on His identity and His character, then all the rest is worthless. And we are at enmity with Christ, no matter what our profession. And so I want to tell you that every false presentation of Christ is a presentation of a false Christ. Did you get that? Every false presentation of Christ is a false Christ. And today there are the modern priests of Baal. They profess to become they profess to be converted, Seventh-day Adventists even, and they profess to be straight on righteousness by faith, but they are infatuated with a false God. Suppose you had lived in Israel in the time of Manasseh. Would you have worshipped at the temple if those services were to praise Baal or Moloch? Would you? What if they didn't use the name Moloch? Maybe they didn't even use the name Jehovah. But they were worshiping Moloch anyhow. Or maybe they'd went so far as to write the name Baal or even the name Moloch or Ashtaroth into their fundamental statements of belief. How would you relate to that? Would you worship there? Would you offer your sacrifices there? Would you entrust your sacrifices to those priests to offer for you? Because, you know, the person who came in, he didn't offer the sacrifice himself. He brought his offering in for the priest to offer. So are you going to take your offering now for the priest of Baal to offer? Are you going to bring your sacred tithe to the priest of Baal so that the priest of Baal can be supported? Why the worship of Jehovah languishes? Are you going to do that? Would have you done that in the year 680 BC? Well, friends, if you wouldn't do it today, you wouldn't do it then. But if you go into the churches today where they're preaching and teaching the Trinity, I fear for you. I fear for you. Amen. That you would have went in to the temple of the Lord at that time when Baal worship had taken over and you'd be worshiping Baal. Friends, God has always made a call to His people. In Joshua 24 and verse 15, Joshua said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." But what are you going to do? And in the time of Elijah, in 1 Kings 18:21, there he said unto those people, he said, "Choose you this day whom you will serve." Choose you this day. Are you going to serve Baal or are you going to serve Jehovah? And I'd like to say that we have not done as well as ancient Israel. I don't think we've done as well as ancient Israel. Because you see, it was just shortly after the time of Elijah that Israel, the northern kingdom, continued back into idolatry. The southern kingdom of Judah went into idolatry. And even after the reforms of Josiah, he had three sons and a grandson sit upon the throne, and they all were bad. Because of the sin of Manasseh. In Joshua 24, while we're thinking of Joshua, just want to make reference to a text there. Because I made a statement that we've not done as well as ancient Israel. In Joshua 24, in verse 31, it says that Israel served the Lord. Now notice it's in your Bibles, it's all capitalized. And Israel served Jehovah all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that overlived Joshua, and which had known all the works of the Lord that he had done for Israel. Ellen White died in the year 1915. Now, I would suppose if we would think of a generation that would overlive her, maybe people who knew her when she was young, we could at least go to the year 1950, 1960-ish, and have people who still knew Ellen White, who had heard her ministry, who knew of the wonders that God had wrought among Israel during her lifetime, wouldn't you? Yeah. So we should at least go to then before we'd start off into apostasy. But may I remind you again that every false presentation of Christ is clearly a false Christ, and very early, after Ellen White died, false presentations of Christ came in. In the year 1919, there was a Bible conference held. And that Bible conference dealt largely with the issue of the doctrine of Christ, who he was. And there was a big push during that conference to accept Jesus Christ as the second person of the Trinity and not the only begotten Son of God. In 1928, we had the publishing of the book, The Coming of the Comforter by Leroy Frum, a fully Trinitarian book, information gathered from Pentecostal people. In 1931, we now have a new statement of belief that actually puts the name of Baal into it. In 1955, 1956, we had the Seventh-day Adventist Evangelical Conferences occurring. And now that we have books of a new order, the Omega is in full swing. In 1967, we have representatives to the Faith and Order Commission of the World Council of Churches. And in 1980, and I'm just looking at a highlight, a very big outline of the history. In 1980, we have a new fundamental statement of belief, the first fundamental statement of belief that's ever been voted by the laity in full general conference session and fully approved. And it has the name of Baal right in it. No, friends, we've not even done as good as Joshua's generation. A new generation that has not known Joseph has arisen. But let us now go back to ancient Israel for a minute. Didn't Josiah bring reform? We read about some of that earlier. He surely tried, but friends, the deep-seated love of Baal could only be superficially removed. All of his sons, including the one grandson that reigned after him, they were all wicked men. They all served Baal. They were all cads. And God makes a statement in 2 Kings 23 that we need to see. 2 Kings 23 and verse 26. Notwithstanding these great reforms that Josiah brought, the Lord turned not from the fierceness of his great wrath, wherewith his anger was kindled against Judah because of all the provocations that Manasseh had provoked him withal. And may I remind you that though Manasseh was one of the most wicked of all kings, he will be in heaven because he repented in his later years and he sought the Lord God earnestly. And the Bible says that God heard his prayer. He heard his entreaty and he blessed him. But friends, he couldn't undo all that had been done by Manasseh's earlier years. And when we lead people into sin, friends, it is a grievous thing to think of that because we maybe can never undo that. And we think about, yeah, well, you know, I don't want to be the guy going out and getting my neighbors on dope and all those things. And no, I don't want to do that either. But friends, when we are teaching these false doctrines, these abominable doctrines, and leading people to hell, we're doing far worse than the drug pusher out here getting people on cocaine and meth. Not to say that that's good either. No, friends, we have not equaled ancient Israel. For at least there was a King Josiah who said, I have had enough. Israel has strayed from false worship. He did not simply say we need revival and reformation. He did not simply say that we could continue living as we were. He did not please the people desiring smooth teachings. Not at all. Josiah stood up and he said, enough is enough. We've been wrong. We have left the worship of Jehovah and we have started to worship Baal, and we're going to do something about this. You know, even the northern kingdom for a time under Jehu had tried to quench Baal worship. Remember Jehu, he had all the priests of Baal come together for a big meeting and killed them all. All the ones that were left or who had arisen since the time of Elijah. And Josiah was this kind of a man. He says, we've had enough. This is it. I'm going to come out and take a position on this. But friends, for a General Conference president to be a Josiah today, he would need to do more than simply be against the ordination of women priestesses for Baal. If you worship Baal, it's only logical and natural that you're going to end up following and eventually having women as priests or priestesses, friends. So these things that we're seeing about this women ordination today, it shouldn't surprise us in the least. No, for a General Conference president today to be a Josiah, he would need to stand up and say, we have been wrong about this Trinity business, and it's time to clean house. And I want to tell you, maybe there have been some good men since the days of Ellen White, but you can count them from Daniels to Branson to Pearson to Wilson too. And not one has made such a call for true revival. Not even Elder Andreessen made such a call. But friends, we have not equaled the history of Israel. And so I think that our text here in 2 Kings, we could see it in a modern light today. It might say something like this. Notwithstanding, the Lord turned not from the fierceness of his great wrath, wherewith his anger was kindled against Silver Springs because of all the provocations that Froom, Anderson, and the seminary had provoked him withal. That's right. Suppose you had lived in Israel in the year 680 B.C. What would you have done? I can tell you what you would have done. You would have done exactly what you're doing in the year 2014 today. If you are still clinging to false hopes and a false system, you're still worshiping Baal. Even among those who have followed the second and fourth angels' messages, we have influences that are trying to enter in among us by false teachings. With teachings on feast days and false views on righteousness by faith, declaring that the old tried and true ideas are outdated. Declaring that the law is outdated, or that the prophetess that God in his wisdom and goodness has sent his people has let us down and therefore should be discarded. These elements come in, and then the cry for unity goes up. And we rush to find unity under the lowest common denominator. Friends, some people will tell you just as long as we believe in the Father and the Son, we should all get along. But this is so superficial, for it should be evident that though we all claim to worship the same Father and Son, this is not so, friends. Because if we did, we would have the same other doctrines too. But all these things systematically affect the way we see things. Beloved, God is calling us to higher ground. But will we follow it? Will we be Elijahs? We've been told that we are to carry an Elijah message, but the only way you can give an Elijah message is if you are an Elijah today. God is calling for purity of character among his people, but beloved, we will become like that which we behold. The Bible is explicit on this. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, we are told that by beholding we become changed. And if we are beholding Baal worship, yet all the time claiming to be worshipers of Jehovah, it will have its effect upon you. Don't think, friends, that you can sin with impunity against God. The Bible says, whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. And if you keep sowing involvement in false worship, and friends, you don't have to go to little places where they have a logo with three wavy lines on it. You can bring it into your house. You can stream it through the internet. You can read it through the books and the magazines. If we behold Baal long enough, we will become Baal. But to be like Jesus, to be like the true Jesus, we have to behold the true Jesus. And he is found, friends, in his word. And we are to study. We are to study now, friends. I want to tell you, you need to study as if your life depended upon it, because it does. It does. Reach out, and the outstretched hand of Jesus is there today to receive you and to help you to find the salvation you need. You know, we can't save ourselves, friends. Think back to Mount Carmel. It was the false prophets of Baal that were screaming and contorting themselves and cutting their flesh, somehow trying to bring about this reaction and appeasement from their God. Suppose you'd been on Mount Carmel. Where would you have stood? Would you have stood with the majority of the multitude, or would you have stood with the majority of one? On Mount Carmel, it was the priests of Baal against one man. But finally, when the fire fell, the people said, "The Lord, He is God." Remember that? The Lord, He is God. But they didn't say it exactly like that. I want you to notice what they said. 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings 18 and verse 39. "And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, 'The Lord, He is the God.'" The Lord, and they're saying Jehovah, is the God. He's not just a God, He is the God. There's now been a distinction made. There's two different gods. And Jehovah is the true God. That's right. In Germany, there's a city called Aachen, and it was the home of the father of Alfred the Great. Edith Frank was from there, the mother of Anne Frank. It's nestled near the border of France. And during World War II, it was surrounded by the American forces. Adolf Hitler had sent orders to the Nazi commander to stand and to die to the last man in the city's defense. But the American commander, Lieutenant General Courtney H. Hodges, was in charge of the Americans, and they wanted to give the city an opportunity to surrender before destroying it. And so he sent an ultimatum to the Nazi commander and to the mayor of this city of 165,000 people, and asking them to please surrender, spare yourself. This city is surrounded. They actually dropped thousands of leaflets or pamphlets to the citizens, telling them to surrender and thus prevent needless bloodshed. And in fact, we have the text here. It says, "Aachen is surrounded. American troops surround the city. The German command cannot relieve you. People of Aachen, the time has come for honorable surrender. We Americans do not wage war on innocent civilians. But if the leaders insist on further sacrifice, we have no course but to destroy your city. There is no time to lose. On our airfields, bombers are waiting for final orders to take off. Our artillery surrounding the city is ready to fire. People of Aachen, act quickly. Tomorrow may be too late. There's only one choice: immediate surrender or complete destruction." If you had been one of the people in the city of Aachen, what would have you done? Suppose you had been one of those people. What would you have done? The Germans didn't surrender, and great destruction ensued. Now, friends, God is trying to warn you today. He's trying to warn each one of us. Destruction is coming. And the only hope we have, friends, is surrender. And it's surrender of ourself, surrender of our soul to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if we don't, destruction cometh. The choice is yours. Choose you this day whom you'll serve. Choose whether you're going to serve Jehovah or Baal. But friends, if you're going to serve Jehovah, you must serve Him fully. You can't serve Him part way. You can't have agreement with the temple of idols. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Second Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness?" Verse 15. "And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel?" And you know, we might not think of those who fall under the second and fourth angels' messages as being infidels. We might not think of them as being unbelievers. But friends, they're not believing in the true God. And there's no agreement between the temple of God and the temple of idols. And we cannot serve the God of heaven, the God of the universe, in temples of idols. If we can't do that, let's be sure that we don't bring the temples into our own houses and worship in that way. But today, the door of mercy is still open. Today, the invitation is still open. Some of the people that we've been praying for, the people we've been working for, our neighbors, our family members, our associates, that we can somehow still reach with the third angel's message. The door is open. But let's be sure, friends, that we're worshiping the God of the three angels' messages first. Let's be sure that we ourselves are uniting upon true biblical principles and not with the temple of idols. May God bless each one.